Good morning, dear students. So, as I said yesterday, that today we'll be starting a new topic that is called sequences and series. Now, for the previous topic, we will evaluate the DPP shortly. But if you have any doubt in any question, the way I address all these things offline with each one of you, please. Do contact me, and I will resolve it within a couple of days. Huh? So, in sequence and series, we will discuss arithmetic progression, geometric progression, arithmetico-geometric progression. And then we'll proceed with infinite series. So let's start with arithmetic progression first. As you know, dear, I hope all of you are able to view the screen very clearly.
Yes.
Any if you face any difficulty, please do let me know.
Yes.
Okay, great. So, dear students, arithmetic progression, a sequence, A1, A2, A3, in that way it goes, okay? Is said to be in arithmetic progression if the difference of two consecutive numbers is constant. That means if you see that A1, A2, A3, the consecutive numbers are A1 and A2 are consecutive, so difference between them is A2 minus A1. Again, A3 and A2 are consecutive, so difference between them is A3 minus A2. So, yeah. A2 minus A1 is equal to A3 minus A2 is equal to A4 minus A3 and so on. Okay. So, what we get? So, if we see this difference is a constant D. So, which means the sequence A1, A2, A3, sequence means is what? It is a, numbers separated by comma that we can define as a sequence. Now, yes. Once that sequence satisfies a particular criteria, we name it. For example, that sequence in this context, we are naming it as arithmetic progression. When? Now, if the difference between the consecutive terms is constant. So what is that? An minus 1 minus an. In generic, we can say an minus 1 minus an is constant D. Okay, for all n belongs to capital N. That is, n is a natural number. Okay. Then we call this sequence is an arithmetic progression. Now, there are important terms about this constant. That constant is known as the common difference. Okay. You know, dear students, apparently, in fact, you have, learned arithmetic progression a little bit in your, previous classes. Okay. In the previous year, I mean. But the point is that, where is the difference is that there are some, we'll learn some a theory which is in depth, and most importantly, when you start solving the numerical problems, okay, then you will find things are you need to really apply this concept along with your existing mathematics knowledge. Okay, as long as the theory is concerned, things are very straightforward. There are some tricks, and those tricks we will be learning today, and those tricks will be helpful to find the to find the solution to problems, straightforward manner. So, what I said in the last few minutes, that is all about arithmetic progression. That is what is an arithmetic progression. As simple as that. It is a sequence of numbers. Now, take the consecutive two numbers, and find their difference. If the difference of the different consecutive numbers is constant, this is arithmetic progression. Done. That is the definition of arithmetic progression.
Okay.
Now what comes is that, it comes is that if I tell you the first term, and if I tell you the, you know, common difference, then can you, and if I tell you the number of terms, can you find the nth term?
Yeah.
Can you tell the sum up to the first n terms? And all relevant things are coming. Okay, and that we are going to discuss it. But very important thing, dear students, there are two points that are very important. Here is the first term. Okay, the first term is denoted by A in general. Okay, in this case, A is equal to A1. That is the first term, if you see. But symbolic representation of first term of a arithmetic progression is A, lowercase a. And next one is that common difference. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Common difference is denoted by D, lowercase d. It is a difference between the consecutive terms. Now, as this difference is common across all consecutive terms, hence the, you know, using of this proper terminology is called common difference. Now, what we are going to do, dear students, is that we are going to find the some key formulas related to arithmetic progression. Okay. So, first of all, these two formulas you need to definitely remember. You know, absolutely you need to remember this thing. And I'm going to place in front of you, dear students. The first one is that, you know, if we know the first term A and the common difference D of an AP, we can find the nth term of the AP, means any terms of that AP. But if we know only first term or only common difference, then arithmetic progression cannot be unique. Correct, na, dear students?
Yes.
If I say, hello, I have a arithmetic progression with first term as 5. Okay, fine. With first term as 5, I can have, you know, many arithmetic progression. I can have 5, 6, 7, 8, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
I can have 5, 7, 9, 11, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
I can have a lot of things. I can have 5, 4, 3, 2, and so on. But what is the common here? In all these, you know, sequences or arithmetic progressions, the common difference is, sorry, the first term is constant, that is 5.
Mm-hmm.
Only informing the first term cannot help us to find the arithmetic progression in definite, in unique manner.
Mm-hmm.
Or other way, if I say only the common difference, you cannot construct that unique arithmetic progression. If I say, hey, I have a arithmetic progression with common difference 2, then we can have a series, we can have a arithmetic progression 1, 3, 5, 7, correct or not?
Yes.
Or we can have 2, 4, 8, and so on, correct or not?
Yeah.
So what we see is that in all these cases, the common difference is 2. But we are not finding, we are not able to find the arithmetic progression in a unique manner, correct or not?
Yes.
So, it is important to have both first term and common difference so that we can construct the arithmetic progression uniquely. For example, if someone is telling me, hey, I have arithmetic progression, you know, can you construct an arithmetic progression with first term is 5 and common difference is 2? I said, yeah, perfect. So it will be, you know, this will be my arithmetic progression.
Mm-hmm.
With first term as 5 and common difference 2. It is not possible to have any other arithmetic progression with first term as 5 and common difference 2. Right, dear students?
Yes.
So that is why, you know, these two terms are very, very important and quite, you know, you use very frequently. What are those terms? The first one is called the, you know, first term A, and second one is called the common difference. We can find the nth term. Nth term means is that suppose I am telling, hey, I have a arithmetic progression with first term is 17 and common difference is minus 4. Can you find what is the 325th term? No problem.
Mm-hmm.
The formula is that Tn is equal to A plus n minus 1 into D.
Mm-hmm.
So what I was telling, hey, I have a arithmetic progression with, first term as, suppose I give the first term as 17 and common difference is equal to minus 4, possible.
Mm-hmm.
And the question is that what is the 317th term? No problem, T317, so A, it is A plus N minus 1, that is 317 minus 1, correct or not?
Into minus 4,
correct. Whatever the value will come, that is the 370th term. So that is the first one. Second one is that, sum up to the first n terms. Sum up to the first n terms. So that is very important. Means it is starting from the first term and goes up to the, in terms. So that is called Sn. And that formula is Sn is equal to n by 2 into twice A plus n minus 1 into D. Correct or not? So how we are going to find, suppose if I say I have an arithmetic progression with first term as minus 4 and common difference as 8. Possible. So can you find the sum of this arithmetic progression up to 112 terms? Yeah, not a big deal. N by 2. 112 by 2. Correct or not?
Yes.
So 2 into A, that means 2 into minus 4 plus n minus 1, that is 112 minus 1 into D, that is into 8. Whatever the value will get, that is the sum up to the first 112 terms of the arithmetic progression with first term as minus 4 and common difference as 8.
Yes.
We are not clear.
Yes.
Now, as we know this thing, we can have, if we find the last term of an arithmetic progression, then we can find the sum up to the first n terms also in different way. You see, what you find Sn, Sn is equal to n by 2 into twice A plus n minus 1 into D.
Mm.
Clear or not clear?
Yes.
So this implies what? This implies Sn is equal to n by 2 into a plus n minus 1 into D. Isn't it, dear students? Can I write this thing?
Yes. Yes.
So now, what is a plus n minus 1 into D? That is nothing but the nth term, correct or not?
Yeah.
So Sn is equal to n by 2 into a plus Tn, that is the nth term. Now, if the nth term is the last term, correct, no?
Mm-hmm.
Got my point? Suppose I have an arithmetic progression 5, 7, 9, 11, 13, and it is actually ending with 15. That is my arithmetic progression, okay?
Yeah.
And we need to find the sum of the AP, right? Of all these terms, correct or not? So how to find that Sn here? Sn is equal to n by 2. That is how many terms are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 by 2. We can have A. A is 5. Plus L. That is 15.
Mm.
Correct or not?
Yes.
That is equal to 3 into 20. That is equal to 60. Or you can apply the formula of our the formula first we learned, n by 2, 6 by 2 into twice into a 2 into 5, correct or not?
Yes.
Plus 2 minus 1, that is 6 minus 1 into D. D is what, 2?
Yeah.
Correct or not?
Yes.
So that is equal to what? 3 into 10 plus 10. That is also equal to 60. So when to use what formula? If we know the first term, common difference, and the sum up to the first n term, that is the value of n, then the best formula to use is that sum up to the first n terms is this one, Sn equal to n by 2 into twice a plus n minus 1 into d. But if we know the first term and the last term, and which term is the last term, that also you need to know, na? Otherwise you cannot find that AP in a unique manner. You know the first term, the last term, and which term is the last term? Which term is the last term? In this case, if you look into this particular example, we know the first term as 5, last term as 15, and we know the last term, which is 15, is a which term? That is a sixth term. Then we can use this formula, that is Sn equal to n by 2 into a plus l. These are fundamental formulas, dear students. Very important. And I hope you know this, most of these, formulas, whatever I've discussed so far, you are already aware of.
Yes.
Now, I am going to give you some, formulas at now, which are very, very important. And you need to memorize it, and we need to apply it as time goes by. And here I'm going to, put it here. Okay. If you have any doubt here, you can ask me. So if you look into the sum up to the first n natural numbers, that is 1 plus 2 plus 3 up to n, that formula is equal to n into n plus 1 by 2. That you can easily establish by means of the arithmetic progression formula, correct or not?
Yes.
Here the first term is 1. Common difference is what? Can someone tell me what is the common difference of this series? 1 plus 1, 2, 3. 1 common difference is also 1.
Yes.
And you know the sum up to the first n terms. So you can apply that formula, n by 2 into twice a plus n minus 1 into d. You will get this one. But you need to memorize this. Okay. This is important to memorize. First one. Second one is what, dear students? It is not in arithmetic progression. 1 square, 2 square, 3 square. It is not in arithmetic progression. But in context of our discussion of sequence and series, you need to memorize this. What is that? It is the sum of the squares of the first n natural numbers. That is 1 square plus 2 square plus 3 square up to n square. And what is that formula, dear students? N into n plus 1 into 2n plus 1 by 6. Now, if you ask me, sir, prove it, definitely we can prove it. And for that, there is a different, class is required, that is called the principle of mathematical induction. Using the principle of mathematical induction, we can prove it very easily. But definitely, we cannot use the formula of arithmetic progression, because that progression is not in arithmetic progression at all. 1 square, 2 square, 3 square, n square, right? As the difference between 2 square and 1 square is not equal to the difference between 3 square and 2 square, not dear students.
Yes.
That is why. But why you need to remember, you may ask, sir, if it is the case, but we are discussing arithmetic progression, then why you bought it? These are the very common series, and that you need to remember. That's why I bought it. The third one is that it is the sum of the cube of the first n natural numbers. That is 1 cube plus 2 cube plus 3 cube, in that way up to n cube. What is that? That is equal to n into n plus 1 by 2 complete whole square. Correct, not dear students? Now, what is happening here is that, how to remember? First, you remember that what is the sum up to the first n natural number? That is 1 plus 2 plus 3 up to n. What about the result is that its square is actually for the sum of the cube of the first n natural number. That is a way to remember it. You see now n into n plus 1 by 2 whole square, not dear students, what you see here. What n into n plus 1 by 2 is nothing but the sum of the first n natural numbers. What you see it here?
Yes.
Correct or not? So what you find? So we find this three. Now, after remembering these three, if you can remember the fourth one, it is even better. Very rarely used. But if you can remember, it is even better. It is 1 power 4 plus 2 power 4 plus 3 power 4 in that way up to n power 4. What is the formula, dear students? It is n into n plus 1 into 2n plus 1 into 3n square plus 3n minus 1 by 30. Okay. All these things we can prove using the principle of mathematical induction. Clear? May I proceed?
Yes.
Okay. Now, the next point what I'm going to discuss, dear students, is that, you know, it's called the arithmetic mean. Okay. What is arithmetic mean? You know, you heard about the term mean, right?
Yes.
Do not. What is called mean? If I say I have two numbers, x and y, what is the mean?
X plus y by 2.
Fantastic. Okay. But the point is that in context of that arithmetic progression, arithmetic mean makes a sense. Let me tell you how. Suppose, so what we are discussing here is that arithmetic mean. Okay. Suppose I say that I have two numbers. First number is A and second number is B. Are there in arithmetic progression? You can always say any two numbers are always in arithmetic progression. Because there is no third term. Now, how come I know the common difference is actually validated or not?
Yes.
Correct?
Yes.
So what is the arithmetic mean between them? The arithmetic mean between them is, as you correctly said, Mohit, A plus B by 2.
Mm.
Now what happened is that we have three terms. First term is A, second term is A plus B by 2, and third term is B.
Mm.
Now, dear students, these three terms are in arithmetic progression. The difference between A plus B by 2 and A is equal to the difference between B and A plus B by 2. Got it? Mm.
Yes.
The difference, you find it out, you will find it out. The difference between A plus B by 2 and A, that is A plus B by 2 minus A. What you are getting?
B minus A by 2.
That is equal to B minus A by 2. And let's find it out between these two. It is B minus A plus B by 2. So here 2B minus B. Here also B minus A by 2.
Yeah.
So we can say they are in arithmetic progression. Nah? Why? Because there is a common difference. The difference between second term and first term is equal to the difference between third term and second term.
Yes.
They are in arithmetic progression. Correct or not?
Yes.
Very good. So now the point is that similarly, we can insert many arithmetic means between them. Suppose if I insert between A and B, K arithmetic means, N arithmetic means we can insert. Okay. We can insert n arithmetic means between them. Then what will be the kth arithmetic mean? Means the point of discussion what I'm going to do is that something like this. Suppose we have our first term A and the last term is B. In between A and B, we are interested to insert, you know, n arithmetic means. The first arithmetic means is A1. Second arithmetic means is A2. Got it, no?
Yeah.
Third arithmetic means is A3. In that way, you will get kth arithmetic mean is AK. Correct, not dear students?
Yes.
And in that way, it continues. It continues. You will find the last is that nth arithmetic mean and then finally the term B.
Yeah.
So what we have done, that capital A1, capital A2, capital A3, capital AK, capital AN are nothing but the n arithmetic means inserted between A and B. Sagni, Gurman, Disha, Srijita, Divansu, absolutely clear? No doubt.
So why you take another variable AK?
Achha, very good. Very, very good question. Thank you very much. It is not AK is a variable. K is a subscript. You see A1, when you write A1, 1 is a subscript. A2 is a subscript. Got it, no?
Yes, sir, but why K?
K is the kth one. There are total N, no? A1, A2, A3, A4, up to AN. So in between A1 to AN, there should be some generic term, no? That is called K.
Oh.
Where the value of K can vary from 1 to N. Are you getting my point? If K is equal to 1, it is A1. If K is equal to 2, it is A2. If K is equal to 3, it is A3. If K is equal to N, it is AN. Correct or not?
Yes, sir.
Are you getting my point? Absolutely clear, Sagnik, dear Sagnik.
Yes, sir, I understand.
Okay. So it is called subscript. When you need to describe, on that variable, that different for different values of what is the value of the variable. You can define this as AR. For example, TN, we define now that nth term like that. So how to find the value of this AK? Okay. So to find the value, that means what? The kth arithmetic mean. To find the value of AK, that is the kth arithmetic mean, it is very simple thing. You write A plus K into B minus A divided by N plus 1. We can establish this also. Okay. Let us establish it, then you'll understand that why sir is saying so. Okay, because not always saying the formula is not good. Sometimes you also get a feeling that how it is getting. You can also prove it. But one thing, dear students, as we see in case of that A between A and B, when we inserted one arithmetic mean, what we found? A plus B by 2 and B, these three are in arithmetic progression, no, dear students?
Yeah.
Correct or not? Similarly, when we insert any arithmetic means, then the entire thing, let me use a different color, the entire sequence, lowercase a to capital A1, A2, A3, AK, up to AN to B, they are in arithmetic progression. Okay, it is in arithmetic progression. It is in arithmetic progression. In short, it is known as AP. Now, as it is in arithmetic progression, what is the first term? First term is A.
A.
Correct or not?
Yeah.
First term is equal to A. That is known to us. Common difference we do not know, na? Correct or not?
Yes.
Let common difference be D. Because the moment we know the common difference, then it is not a big deal to find the AK, right? Let assume the common difference is D. What is our task, dear students? Our task is to find the value of D. That's it. Value of D in terms of what? In terms of the items what we are aware of, what we are known actually, what is given to us, that is lowercase a, lowercase b, k and n.
Yes.
Correct, no? So now, what is AK? Think about. Can someone please tell me, in that arithmetic progression where the first term is A, second term is capital A1, third term is capital A2, fourth term is capital A3, in that way, AK, and then continues up to AN and then B, AK is which term of this arithmetic progression? AK is which term of the arithmetic progression?
K minus 1.
A plus K minus 1 into.
Yeah.
First of all, which term it is? Which term? What number of terms? First term, second term, third term, fourth term, fifth term. What is that? Like that.
Yes.
K minus 1.
No, neither is correct. Can someone please give an answer? Disha? It is actually K plus 1 term. See how A1 is which term of this arithmetic progression? Second term, na?
Got it.
Dear Sagnik? Hello,
yes,
dear
sir. Yes, sir.
A1 is the second term. A2 is the third term. A3 is the fourth term. Now, look at the pattern. So, AK should be the K plus 1th term. Correct or not?
Yes.
So, K plus 1th term of that arithmetic progression. Correct or not? Of the AP. So, now we know if it is a K plus 1th term of an arithmetic progression, how to find it out? It is a first term plus N minus 1 K plus 1 minus 1 into D.
Yeah.
Correct or not?
Yes.
So from here, so this implies AK is equal to A plus K into D. Correct or not? AK is equal to A plus K into D. Correct or not?
Yes.
Now, what is our task? Our task, we know what is lowercase A. We know what is lowercase K. Correct or not?
Yeah.
But we do not know what is D. Can someone give me some idea how we can find the value of D? Some idea. It may be wrong, no problem. But you can give some idea. If you want to. Disha, Divyanshu, Gurman, Srijita, what is your statement? Now tell me, what is B? B is which term?
Last term.
Last term. I understood last term. But what is that term? Last term is what?
N plus 2.
Correct. N plus 2th term. Perfect.
Yeah.
Correct or not?
Yes.
So what we see is that B is equal to N plus 2th term. Dear Gurman, everything is clear, na?
Yes, sir.
Disha?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Srijita, Divyanshu, absolutely clear?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
A plus N minus 1, that means N plus 2 minus 1. Correct or not?
Yeah.
Into D?
Mm-hmm.
So this implies, so we get the value of B is equal to this. This implies B is equal to A plus N plus 1 into D. So from here we can find the value of D in terms of the known, you know, terms we know, that is B minus A by N plus 1.
Yeah.
Correct or not?
Yes.
We get B minus A by N plus 1.
Mm-hmm.
Now that value of D, which is B minus A by N plus 1, We can apply here, substitute here. So what we get, AK is equal to A plus K into B minus A divided by N plus 1. Isn't it, dear student? That is what is the formula here. So there may be some questions, especially for your board examination, that okay, between two numbers, one number is 5 and second number is minus 320. Between these two numbers, insert 11, you know, arithmetic means. Not a big deal if you know the formula. Because you know what is the value of A, you know what is the value of B, that is the first term and last term. You know what is the value of N? How many arithmetic means I need to insert? Then you just make the value of, you know, AK. Correct or not?
Yeah.
Clear or not clear?
Yes.
Point is that here the value of K is 1, 2, 3, up to N. Correct or not?
Yeah.
This way also you can represent, or you can represent that 1 less than equal to k less than equal to n and k belongs to the set of natural numbers.
Mm-hmm.
Correct, na?
Yes.
Absolutely clear. So k is equal to 1, 2, 3 up to n, or 1 less than equal to k less than equal to n. and k belongs to capital N, the set of natural numbers. Both of you have representation. I'm just giving the different flavor. That's it.
Yes.
Okay. So let me now tell you the underlying theory. Okay. And you find it out, quite understandable now, as we have discussed. But as I say, that in your board examination, in entrance examination, this will never come. That, okay, insert, arithmetic means between two numbers. But in board examination, it is important. Clear, not dear students? I hope quite understandable. Okay. Now, another very interesting point we are going to discuss. You will get some questions in both board examination and entrance examination, not in direct form, but in indirectly, that where you need to assume, some consecutive terms of an arithmetic progression. Okay, there may be you will get questions, you need to construct an arithmetic progression in which the sum of the three consecutive terms is a number, suppose 65. Now, how to choose those three numbers? Very important. Mm-hmm. Some of you are already aware of, but I want to repeat this thing because I want to give a generic one. Mm-hmm. Now, there is a reason why we choose like this. There is a specific way of choose like this. Okay. So, what is the point here? The point here is that if you know the sum of three consecutive numbers of an AP, suppose I'm telling you, I have an AP and sum of the three consecutive numbers is 65. Now, how you are going to choose those three numbers? Okay. So, someone can answer, please.
A minus D, A and A plus D.
Fantastic. Correct. So if you know the sum of three consecutive numbers of an AP, but you do not know the numbers, obviously, correct? Then the way to assume A minus D, A and A plus D, why so? Because as it is given in the statement that you know the sum of these three consecutive numbers. So the moment you add them, you will see D get cancelled, correct or not?
Yeah.
The moment you add that A minus D, A and A plus D, that sum is given, na? A minus D plus A plus A plus D, that sum is given, suppose, P, for example. Then what do you get? You get 3A equal to P, na?
Yes.
And eventually you get A is equal to P by 3.
Mm-hmm.
The moment you know A equal to P by 3, you can find the value of D. That's it.
Yes.
Correct or not? But for that, another condition has to be given. You cannot find it deterministic. Correct? Huh? As I said in the initial of the discussion of the class, that just by knowing the first term, or just by knowing only the common difference, just by knowing only the first term, or just by knowing only the common difference, you cannot construct a arithmetic progression uniquely.
Mm-hmm.
Correct, no? Because with this first term, that is P by 3, we can have multiple, set of three numbers whose sum is, P. Possible.
Mm-hmm.
Correct, no? Instead of D, we can write 2D. A minus 2D, A, A plus 2D. That also, sum should be P, no? 3A.
Yeah.
So, another condition will be given for which you need to find the value of D.
Mm-hmm.
But the point here is simple. Point is what? If you know the sum of three consecutive numbers of an AP, but you do not know the numbers, assume the numbers as A minus D, A and A plus D. Correct, no?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yes. Now let us, increase it to, if you know the sum of four consecutive numbers of an AP, but you do not know the number, what will be the numbers you choose, dear students? Can someone answer, please? Taknik, Virman, Disha, Srijita, Devansu. You know the four consecutive terms. You know the sum of the four consecutive terms. So the technique here is that. Mohor, any answer from you?
So is it A minus 3D, A minus D, A plus D and A plus 3D.
Fantastic. Absolutely correct. Very good. Appreciate, Agni. So, if there are four consecutive numbers of an AP, then the numbers would be A minus 3D, A minus D, A plus D, and A plus 2D. If you notice, the difference between two numbers, A minus 3D and A minus D, it is what? It is, you know, 2D.
Yeah.
Similarly, between A minus D and A plus D and A minus D, the difference is 2D.
Mm-hmm.
Similarly, A plus 3D and A plus D, the difference is 2D.
Mm-hmm.
Correct or not?
Yes.
But the advantage is that the moment you add all these guys, A minus 3D, A minus D, A plus D, A plus 3D, you will get 4A. And that is equal to what is some number is given, no?
Yes.
So, but you say, no, sir, I do not want to choose like that. I want to choose T1, T2, T3, T4. Choose it. No problem. But you are unnecessarily introducing four unknowns.
Yeah.
You can say. But that will, and with that also, you can solve your problem. But it will take very long time. Not very long time. It will take long time. Little longer time than this procedure. Correct or not? So there should be always justification why we should choose like this. Because choosing like this will help us to find solution quickly. Correct or not?
Yes.
Now let's find the problem that, you know, let's increase the problem a little bit. Now if you need to choose five consecutive numbers of an AP whose sum is given to us, but we do not know the numbers, what will be the numbers? Gurman, Divansu, Adiksha, Sujita, can you please answer? I'll appreciate if any one of you can answer this.
So is it A minus 2D, A minus D, A plus D, A plus 2D?
Fantastic. Appreciate. Good. So it is so correct. Now the point is that what you get is that all of you got it, no? So yes, students. So as Gurman said correctly, that if you need to choose five consecutive numbers of an AP, but you do not know the numbers. Okay. Assume the numbers as A minus 2D, A minus D, A plus D, A plus 2D. Correct? And few of things you are already aware of. I am also know because in your previous year, this topic was there. But now let us generalize this problem. What is that? In general, you know, if two M plus one numbers in AP, we need to choose whose sum is given, you want to choose something like this. Okay? Okay. These two statements are very generic statements. Please concentrate here for some time. So what is that? In general, you know, 2m plus numbers in AP, 2m plus 1 numbers in AP can be taken as A minus MD, A minus M minus 1D, A minus D, A plus D, A plus M minus 1 into D, and A plus MD. Correct? Huh? So why so? Now you apply the value of M is equal to, you know, 1. If you apply the value of M equal to 1, you will get A minus D, A plus D, which is the first case. Correct or not? Dear students, all of you got it?
Yes.
Disha, absolutely clear?
Yes, sir.
Now, suppose you put M equal to 2, then what you get? 2M plus 1 is actually 5. Then the term should be A minus 2D, A minus D, A plus D, and A plus 2D. That is this case. Correct or not? And so on. Mohar, is it clear? Absolutely.
Yes.
Now, in general, this is the first case. In general, if you need to choose that, you know, odd consecutive numbers, that is 2m plus 1 is an odd number, no? For any value of m as an integer, means natural number, especially to say.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in general, if 2m numbers in AP, we can take that as A plus 2m minus 1 into D, A plus 2m minus 3 into D, in that way A minus 3D, A minus D, A plus D, A plus 3D, A plus 2m minus 3 into D, A plus 2m minus 1 into D. If you can remember these two formulas for 2m plus 1 and 2m, it will be, you don't need to remember the previous ones, correct or not?
Yes.
But if you cannot recall, okay, again, remembering or not remembering, it is all about priorities. First, you need to remember the fundamentals, that you should not compromise. After that, you can remember, that is great. If you do not remember, it is not that great, it is little difficult. Correct, my dear students?
Yes.
Okay. Now, I am going to show you a procedure by which you can find whether certain numbers belong to a given AP or not. You will get some questions sometime. Find whether 35 belongs to this AP or not. Mm-hmm. That AP is given. Okay, first two terms is given and the nothing is given. First two terms is sufficient to determine the arithmetic progression, na?
Yes.
Because the moment first two terms is given, you know what is the first term and what is the common difference.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but and then it is asking, tell me whether 35 is a, you know, term in this AP or not. These kind of questions you get sometime. But how to go with this one, correct or not? Mm-hmm. So there is a very step-by-step procedure to find that one. Okay, look at here, that it needs to be determined whether a certain number belongs to a given AP or not. Whenever we get this kind of question, I strongly recommend you to follow the steps as I'm going to say now. The step one, let us consider the given number, say P, be the mth term of a given AP. Okay, if possible, you know, that is called the method of contradiction.
Mm-hmm.
I hope you know a little bit about the method of contradiction. Suppose you have been given to disprove something. Okay, so you assume, okay, what has been given as disproved? Let's assume it is possible.
Mm-hmm.
And with that assumption, we come to a conclusion which is absurd. Then we say, no, our assumption was wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Let me give you an example from your, what you did in the last year. Very generic question comes now. Prove that root 2 is an irrational number.
Yes.
Then what do you do generally? If possible, let root 2 be a rational number.
Yeah.
What has been proved, we just take the opposite and let's assume it is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So then after that assumption, we express root 2 is equal to p by q, and then we get something which is absurd, which doesn't satisfy the definition of a rational number or the relationship between P and Q.
Yes.
H shape of P and Q has to be one, na? If you recall, I'm just reading it out, okay, from my mind.
Mm-hmm.
When you express a number as a rational number, it has to be expressed in the form of P by Q, where Q is not equal to zero and HCF of P and Q is equal to one. The moment it has been proved root 2 is an irrational number. So our first assumption is that if possible, let root 2 be a rational number. And with that assumption, we prove that no, P and Q, A step is not one, there is something else. So that means what? Our assumption was wrong?
Mm-hmm.
Similarly here, let us for possible, if possible, we do not know whether that particular term belongs or not, doesn't belong. So let us consider, yes, it belongs. Let P be the mth term of the given AP.
Mm-hmm.
Correct, no?
Yeah.
In which AP means what? You know two things, the first term and the common difference.
Mm-hmm.
Let us consider the given number. So suppose the question here is that tell whether P belongs to this AP or not, whose first term is A and common difference is D.
Mm-hmm.
Correct?
Yeah.
We assume first is that let's assume, yes, P be a term of this AP whose first term is A and common difference is D, and that is the mth term, for example.
Okay.
Then we'll get this equation, obviously, na? Mth term, that means A plus M minus 1 into D is equal to P. That has to be true for some m, na?
Yes.
Now you solve this value for m. How it is very easy to solve? Because mm-hmm. the moment you know a plus m minus 1 into d is equal to p, all are known to you except m. Correct, na?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
From what do you find the value of m minus 1? M minus 1, you get p minus a by d. Correct?
Yeah.
From here, you find the value of m is equal to 1 plus p minus a by d. Correct, no?
Yes.
Now, if that value m is a natural number, we can say yes, that number p belongs to a, you know, belongs to that AP. Why? Because m cannot be an, you know, fractional number. If we get m equal to, suppose, 2.3, what does it mean? Yes. P is a number, P belongs to that AP whose term is 2.3. It is absurd, right? It is not possible to have 2.3 as term.
Yeah.
The term would be natural number, first term, second term, third term, fourth term, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
There is nothing called 2.5 terms. Not possible, no?
Excellent.
So that is why after step 2, you need to go to step 3. If the value of M thus obtained is a natural number, then we conclude, yes, the certain number which is considered as P belongs to the given AP. Otherwise, if we get the value of M as real number with decimal numbers, we conclude, no, that certain number which is considered as P does not belong to the given AP. Correct, na, dear students?
Yes.
Absolutely clear, na? Disha, yes. Absolutely clear, na? Srijita, absolutely clear, na?
Yes.
Divansu, absolutely clear, right?
Yes.
Any doubt, Gurman? Any doubt, Sagnik?
Okay.
Absolutely, fantastic. Because see, that my style of teaching is that, you know, to give you step by step procedure. In the entire 2 years, you'll find, because the moment you get this question, you're in your exam hall. When you get this question, you go to this class. Or relevant practice, that what Konar sir has told, oh, these are the 3 steps I need to follow. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, without following that steps also, you can achieve a solution. But that will take longer time. Absolutely for sure.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying anything which is, you know, rocket science or something.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, I am saying something which is very methodical. If you follow these steps, you'll get the solution quickly. That doesn't mean that if you do not follow these steps, you will not get a solution. You will get solution, but it will take longer time.
Mm.
Okay, and it is not possible to have a time less than steps lesser than this.
Mm.
That's why it is important to remember the steps.
Mm.
And relevant practice, that we will discuss. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So now the point is that, I would like to, conclude the class here today. Okay. And I'll tell you that what all DPPs you need to solve, and I'll give some assignments also. But before that, I would like to show you, let me stop sharing this and let me share the Konar classes website, because I need to exactly tell you which DPP you need to look into. So I'm going to share another screen with you. I hope you're able to view the screen, dear students, konarclasses.com.
Yes.
And as all of you have login, then I'm not just explaining, I'm just going to login. And after successful login, you come to write online examination. Here you just type sequence and series, you get the DPP, first DPP. Okay. You know, solve couple of DPPs. Okay. 2 DPPs first. Okay.
Set 1 and set 2.
You'll find it very easy. But dear students, solving all these DPPs will give you 2 things. First, confidence. First, it will give you that your foundation is rock solid. Believe me. That is the first confidence. And second one is that it will actually prepare you for the year. Now I can approach relatively difficult questions in the practice test. Okay, you got my point? Then you go to the second one. Second one also you'll get, you know, this kind of question. So first two you give, correct, no? And then we'll resume our discussion, you know, tomorrow at 9:30 a.m. I'm just exploring one thing with each one of you. Is it possible if we start class a little early morning, maybe at 6:30? Possible by anyone?
Morning.
Difficult. Huh? Okay. Actually, I have time either at 6:30 in the morning. Okay, if this time is a little difficult by you, then or in the evening 6:30 also we can have. Okay. Anyway, we will take it offline in our WhatsApp group. We'll discuss in details that what can be. But you can also tell me your suitable times. We'll take it. Okay. Anyway, let's not discuss here. Let's continue in our WhatsApp. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much, dear students. If you have any specific question, please do let me know. Otherwise, we can conclude the class here.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.